episode is all about living the dream, owning a flying service in a picturesque location, and having adventures and flying all kinds of aircraft for all kinds of reasons. I'm Paula Williams, and you're watching or listening to Contrails and Cocktails. Our guest, Steve Short, has not had a short career. He has spent about 37,800 hours, which totals about 4 years in total, in the sky. He's done scenic flights with tourists and fishermen, flying supplies and even cadavers wherever they need to go. He talks about his life with the Adirondacks Flying Service and as the airport manager for the Lake Placid Airport. Contrails and Cocktails is sponsored by Global Aircraft Group. Global Aircraft Group offers desktop appraisals, expert witnesses, pre-buy inspections. Mark Perry is the founder, and he is located in New England. He travels free of charge to anyone in New England with a situation that needs his services. You may need an aircraft appraisal for a transaction, an estate settlement, a divorce, a legal situation, whatever it is. If you've got a problem involving aircraft values, Mark can solve it. So let's jump into the episode and into the conversation with Steve and Mark.
Yeah, I've had the flying service for going on 49 years now, and you do a lot of flying in this business, and so I've got a bit over 38,000 logged hours now, a fair amount more than that unlogged, it's been a wonderful career. I'm looking to sell it and fly for the buyer part-time, and I'm needing to get out west to Bellingham, Montana, where my kids and grandkids all are.
Nice.
So, anyway, but it's been quite an experience.
Maybe you have a highlight or a story you'd like to share?
Well, highlights. One of the highlights was the day I started. My father had the business before I did. He had it, he took an early retirement to work for a fellow from Tupper Lake, Elfernia. My father took an early retirement. Elfernia started Adirondack Flying Service in Lake Placid. He just got a trailer and lived on the airport.
Oh, wow.
My father came up and flew charter for him. And unfortunately, Elfernia got cancer and soon died. And my father, 3 years later, had a subarachnoid hemorrhage. And I was working for Kodak at the time, building flying time, thinking of an airline career. But my mother called and said your dad is sick, and is there any way you can come up and take all of these flights that are scheduled? And so I came up I got a leave of absence from Kodak, came up the next day, and I knew nothing about Part 135 at the time, and I just flew 13 hours on my first day. That was the most hours that I've ever flown in one day.
That's a lot of flying.
Actually, not counting flying out west, Part 91. Mm-hmm. That was my introduction to running a flying service. And my father never recovered. Mm-hmm. So, there happened to be somebody at the FAA where I was dropping off a cadaver. We did quite a bit of flying air hearse in the early years. And so I got a call from him the next day saying, well, you can't just do that, but they're very good about it. They gave me a check ride and gave me their approval to fly. So, it all started from there. And, I started with a bunch of students and, at the time I only had a 172 and a Cessna 206, both of them flying an off lot. And I was the only pilot at the time. Then my director of maintenance, my mechanic for well over 40 years, he's retired since, but he also, his love was actually flying as well as maintaining aircraft, and he did a great job all these years, kept me we've never had a crash. I think largely because of him.
So you have a perfect record.
I guess I'm an agnostic, but I think I have a guardian angel up there. And I really feel that way.
A lot of talent.
Everybody at the airport says that... there'll be lousy weather, thunderstorm over the airport, winds howling, and somehow the clouds break away and I come in and it's a nice day. so that makes me wonder.
That's fantastic.
Gotta have a guardian angel of some sort up there.
Right.
It's been very good. I've had a number of engine outs in the twins. Fortunately, they were always in the twins. So I never had an off-field landing.
Wow.
That I had to do. And I've taken off from somebody else's off-field landing, but in a 182. That was exciting. It was a short field that had to mow the field, and that worked out fine.
Good.
There are all sorts of wild experiences that you have to have in 38,000 hours of flying. Some of them weren't really dangerous, but they seemed really, really, really dangerous. I was flying an old Mooney that I bought and my mechanic repaired, and I took my family at the time to do a flight around the country. Went all the way down to San Diego, then up to LA, and stayed with my cousin for a day or three, and then was trying to get off early to take off for San Francisco so that we could see the cliffs along the way off Highway 1 there. Unfortunately, we didn't. I wasn't able to get off until after dark. And so I was flying right up the coast and there was, we were flying right over the primitive area where the Hearst Castle is. I saw the lights of the Hearst Castle,
wow.
Castle, but it's a primitive area. And all I could see, it was dark. So I could make out the road winding along the cliffs below me. And it was winding enough, so there was no way I could land on it.
A windy road.
And I saw the waves crashing against the rocks below that. So my options weren't real good if the engine just quit. But I was just flying around. The engine was just purring, and then all of a sudden, bam, 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 bam. That was not nice.
No.
And I tried to figure out what it could possibly be. I gained some altitude, but I couldn't see that gaining the altitude was doing any good because I was over the primitive area. And as far as I could glide from a large, high altitude, none of the options seemed good. And then I eliminated my exhaust sacks because, well, they looked just about brand new. They were silvery and not all black and tarnished. And
yeah.
But I eventually landed just north of Carmel. And the mechanic the next day took it apart. And sure enough, it was the exhaust. I don't know how it could have broke, but it was just the, I probably had more power than ever, but, actually I think the second person I ever took up for, took for a ride after I got my pride, that was interesting. The landing, it was a very hot day. It was in a blank of 1413 that most people know what that is, but it, the forerunner of just about the original forerunner of the Blanca Viking. And the Viking is a tri-gear plane, but this was a tail dragger. It was a four-place, low wing, wood wing. Very nice flying airplane. It basically, the emergency means of pulling the gear up is really the way you got the gear up. You just crank the crank for 52 times and you get three green, and then you can land.
Wow.
But anyway, I was operating out of a, it was about a 1600 foot runway, and the cross runway was only about 1400 feet. I had never landed on the cross runway, but the winds were right down the cross wind runway. The shorter runway.
Mm-hmm.
But it had, it was very sort of hilly. It had fairly high rises and descents on that 1400 feet. So I did my best to land on the backside of one of those rises, and didn't make it. It hit the next rise, so I bounced about 15 feet high and came down. And the other thing, besides being 1,400 feet long, it had telephone wires right at the end of the runway. And it's hot, not very good performing. And I decided that I was going to have to not go around. I didn't feel that was an option at that point. So I was probably going 20 miles an hour, about 40 feet from the end of the runway. And I just did had to do a tail loop. I just hit the left rudder real hard and spun it around and added power. And
Which airport was this?
This was an airport just off of Canandaigua, New York.
Okay.
It was a little grass strip, a little private grass strip.
Oh.
And I'm right now I'm having a trouble coming up with the name of it, but it's
that's okay.
Don't think it's there anymore.
Oh, okay. Gotcha.
And something kind of similar happened with one of my best customers. And I had a pilot that I wanted him to, he was a fairly new pilot, and he was a good pilot. I wanted him to fly left seat so he could impress the customer so I could use him to fly him again.
Nice.
But I was sitting right seat, and we had gone down to White Plains to pick up the customer. And we came back, and it was a nice day when we left. And when we came back, it was a pretty nice day. Unbeknownst to me, we had been getting a heavy freezing rain that came by. Mm. And from the air, you couldn't tell that there was any ice on it at all. It looked perfectly normal. It was black ice.
Oof.
But anyway, he touched down, and we have a displaced threshold there. Well, he dutifully landed beyond that.
Of course,
and
yeah.
And he said, uh-oh. And I said, what's wrong? And he said, there's no braking. And so I asked him, do you have a plan? And he, no. And so I said, all right, why don't you give it to me? And I had never done this before, but I had played it through in my mind a number of times, always from the left seat, though.
Yeah.
We were still barreling down the runway in a Cessna 414, we were probably going 50 miles an hour when we had maybe two 200 feet left.
Oh.
But there's a turnaround area, so I threw in left power to get it pointed into the turnaround area. And then once we got in the turnaround area, I took the left power off, right power on, heavy, and it swung around and did the same thing, a little bit like that first or the second landing with the passenger with my private. I just swung it around, aimed it down the runway. It wasn't pretty. I think it could have been a lot better if I could have done it left the right-handed, but it we got it slowed way down to maybe 7 or 8 miles an hour, but it was the nose was going. We were getting to the edge of the runway on the right side of the runway in the direction that we were pointed, and the nose kept going around and to the original direction, and the nose just went off the end of the runway. So, whew.
Wow.
Anyway, no damage again, and my passenger had a lot of questions, but
I'm sure
it all ended well.
Did your passenger ever fly with you again?
Oh yeah.
Then well, you're he had successful
flown with me a number of times, and you know, when it was explained to him that we were on black ice, and I explained to him that we had no idea that there was black ice on there. That
right.
Otherwise, we wouldn't even have been landing there.
Right.
And by the time that we discovered it, it was too late to go around.
Yeah.
He was very understanding and appreciative of the fact that we got it stopped without any injuries.
Yeah, that's for so, sure.
Yeah, he. I've flown him probably 100 times since then. So.
Wow. Great. Well.
Faithful customers.
Yeah, exactly. That's fantastic to have that kind of loyalty.
I was like Lake Placid. I remember growing up, they used to always, on Sundays, they used to have the worldwide Olympics when I was a kid, and they'd show that poor ski jumper crashing at the end of the, and I think that was Lake Placid. I think that was Lake Placid.
ABC's the Wide Road of Sports introduction to this.
That was up there. Okay.
The agony of defeat. I remember that.
You have snow on the ground up there?
We do. We got plenty of snow. We don't have a lot of snow right now. We've had over a foot, and we're supposed to get about a foot today. But I don't know if you can see it out the window from here.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. We got 3 inches here in 4 hours south of you.
Yeah, skiing conditions should be a lot better tomorrow.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention that when I first started talking to Steve, he found me off of the aircraft dealer network for a referral, and he's in process of selling his charter business with 5 aircraft up in Lake Placid. Mm-hmm. Well, I think it's contingent right now, but I did want to put a plug in for that.
I appreciate that.
It was quite a nice operation, ready to go up in Lake Placid with 5 aircraft and fuel farms and hangar building, all 9 yards for somebody that wants to run a nice business out of Lake Placid.
Yeah, wow. We have 2 twins. The Cessna 421, the Cessna 414. Then we have 4 singles, one of which I hope to keep. Cessna 206, Cessna 177RG, and the Cessna 172 that we use for Scenics primarily, and the Cessna A152 Aerobat. So, got a nice collection of aircraft.
So, which one are you keeping?
I'd like to keep the Cardinal RG.
That's your favorite.
The people that are I think will buy it. They really wanted the RG, so I might let them have it. They said I could use it anytime. Mm-hmm. And I'll be looking for another one then.
Okay, that's fair.
It's a great airplane for a great personal airplane. Very efficient, about 145 knots, 167 miles an hour or so. And that's that on about 10.5 gallons of fuel.
Nice.
Or if you go up high to catch tailwind, get up at 12,000 feet or so, and you're only doing about 55%, you can fly at about 7 gallons an hour and still making about 135 knots. Mm-hmm. Through the air, plus whatever tailwind you might have. So it's a very efficient 4-seater. That's nice. Room. Yeah.
Well, it sounds like that business would be a great opportunity for somebody. You know, it sounds like a great life for someone that enjoys the Lake Placid area.
the way I look at it is it beat working for a living.
That's for sure.
Yeah, I really enjoy the flying. Once I get on the ground, it's business gets in the way, but
yeah, then it's work.
But it's it's a great all around flying experience. With I enjoy instruction. I've got a few students now, one of which would like to go 50-50 with me on the Cardinal if I don't have to sell it.
That's popular. Everybody wants the Cardinal.
Yeah. Wow. In fact, I have to go and pick him up in Burlington in 1 hour and 10 minutes.
Cool. Yeah.
Very good.
But
great. So, Mark, did you want to carry on with anything else you want to?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I'd like to also mention and thank Steve. He's also a Marine.
Yes. Thank you for your service.
Somehow manages to do a lot of push-ups per day. I think he said 100. he set a competition for me to try to keep up with that.
That's amazing.
Yeah, it's not quite 100. It's about 70. I try to do
70. That's right.
Three days in a row, and then take a break, and not, then another three. But yeah,
that's what I'm going to.
Yeah,
do.
That's. I've always considered health being most any person's most important thing in life. If you don't have it, you don't have anything. So right. I work on it.
My son and I do competitions on the Apple Watch, you know, so he gives me a 30% handicap because I'm old. But he's in his 30s, so, you know, there you go.
You don't look old.
Oh, thank you. But he's an Army guy. And my husband is Army and Air Force.
I'm the 76-year-old here.
Wow.
76-year-old Marine.
Well, you don't look it.
My son's Army.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I did spend an interesting year in Vietnam.
Oh.
But.
Wow.
But it was that. I was hoping to fly in the Marine Corps.
Mm-hmm.
And I really wanted to fly F-4 Phantoms. Because I thought that was just such a cool jet. And I was, before I went into the Marine Corps, I was going to college. I just went to a junior college to get a degree, associate's degree in applied science, which the airlines were requiring at the time.
Yeah.
But I didn't take any ROTC, so I had to go to boot camp first, and that was a lot of fun in the Marine Corps.
Oh, I'm sure. I've heard about the Marine Corps boot camp.
Yeah. But my recruiter promised me that I would be flying in 6 months. I would be in Pensacola getting checked out in jets and getting my flight training. As it turns out, there was a year and a half, 2 year waiting list for OCS. Mm. And, I then found out that, after boot camp that, I could fly jets. But the first tour of duty would be no doubt helicopters. And I thought, helicopters here in Vietnam. In the Marine Corps.
Yeah.
I didn't stand a real good chance of coming back. Yeah. And I would get out, and I figured 7.5 years with only helicopter experience. So that wouldn't help much in getting into the airline. So I just stayed enlisted, and I worked on F-4 Phantom. So I got a few rides in it in the back seat because I worked on their intercept radar.
Ah, nice.
In a sense, I was, I wasn't thinking about this when I went in, but the Marine Corps was mostly air to ground.
Yeah.
And I'm glad I didn't have to drop napalm on a bunch of kids that probably didn't want to be there.
Yeah.
So.
Right.
I'm glad you defended our country.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
Appreciate it.
We did what we could.
Well, I appreciate your service. That's
coming off of Pearl Harbor and December 7th, and not hardly any mention on the news. And
it happened to be my birthday as well.
Oh, wow.
Not the original December 7th, but in 46.
Of course. I bet that changed your birthday forever. And a lot of other things too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, thank you for your service.
Ready for a cocktail?
Yes. I'm ready for a cocktail.
Yeah. All right.
It's only 11 o'clock in the morning here, but what the heck?
All right. Yeah. Well,
I'd love to join you, but I got to fly here.
That's all right. We'll symbolically.
Today's cocktail, you could use a mocktail, and so it's going to be a mocktail.
Nice.
Maybe today. Also, because it's too early also.
Yeah.
But I did have a little Santa joke. And it's question is, how much did Santa pay for his sleigh?
No idea.
Okay. How much did Santa pay for his sleigh? Five reindeer.
$5 would be a good answer, but no.
$5. Okay. Yeah.
That's actually
there we go.
That is a good joke.
No, the actual pun. He paid nothing. It was on the house.
It was on the house. Okay, fine.
So today's cocktail is really just a very simple eggnog with whipped cream with cinnamon.
Sounds great.
They recommend you add a little bourbon.
Nice.
Yeah.
That is very simple, but nice.
In the camera or not, I don't know.
I can see it. Yeah. It looks beautiful.
Yeah. No, you could see it well.
Okay, good. So, that's today's. I think I might do a separate Christmas cocktail podcast.
Okay.
That we could do separately also.
Perfect.
But, that's today's cocktail. And it's called Jingle Bells Jet Fuel Smells.
Jingle Bells Jet Fuel Smells. I love it.
Yeah.
How much more can you put in there?
That on the podcast. I may have to get a better name.
That's all right. So how much bourbon do you put in there? I mean,
I personally would put just one ounce.
Okay. In a 8 ounces of eggnog or 6 ounces of eggnog?
Six 6 ounces of eggnog.
Okay.
1 ounce of bourbon. With whipped cream and a sprinkle of cinnamon or nutmeg or both.
Nice.
Sounds delicious.
Yeah. Cool. I might just do the bourbon, the whipped cream, and the cinnamon. I'm not a big eggnog person, but that's okay.
Yep, that would work too, however you want to do it.
Right. Oh, fantastic.
Yeah.
Great. Well, I think that's a wrap. If we want to go around the table and everybody can tell us how you can be found, if you're on LinkedIn, email, whatever you want to say if someone wants to get in touch with you. I'm Paula Williams, ABCI. You can find us on the web and on any social media.
Mark Perry, Global Aircraft Group, based out of New England. Cover all of New England. Travel fees are waived and also reduced all the way from D.C. out to New York.
Nice.
All right. And I'm Steve Short with the Adirondack Flying Service in Lake Placid, New York. And I hope to be here for many years to come, taking part in the business that I hope to sell in a short while.
But,
Yeah.
It's been a great ride.
Fantastic. Well, all the best and happy holidays to all of you, and we will see you soon.